I'm honored to be here today to just talk a little bit about our partnership and to introduce our next speaker. One of the things that I did want to say is that we've started a compassionate care program with ASA Canada. So for anybody who calls the helpline at ASA Canada and they don't have access to the financial means for an air chamber, ASA Canada will provide one to them for free. Something else that we're very proud of is that Trudell has one of the most advanced aerosol labs in the world. And we invite people to come and do tours of that aerosol lab because it provides a lot of great insight into what we do and the benefits of aerosol delivery. But most importantly, I'm honored here today to present our next speaker, Dr. PJ Subbarao. Dr. Subbarao is a clinician scientist and pediatric respirologist. She's the director of the pulmonary function laboratory at the Hospital for Sick Children. She's also the director and Toronto site leader of the Canadian Healthy Infant Longitudinal Development or Child Study. She is an associate professor in the Department of Pediatrics and Physiology at the University of Toronto. Dr. Subbarao has held a new investigator award from CIHR for clinical research, and her lab has been continuously funded by CIHR and Allergen NCE. Her interests are in studying longitudinal objective lung functional measurements from infancy to improve diagnostics and phenotyping of asthma. In studying longitudinal trajectories of lung function and relating them to environmental exposures, she hopes to understand the developmental origins of chronic obstructive lung disease and factors related to persistence and remission. Please welcome warmly Dr. PJ Subbarao.
Thank you. So I think we're continuing along in the theme of really trying to establish diagnoses. So, So thank you so much for that introduction. Same problem, I don't think it's advancing.
No, it doesn't. It's delayed.
Oh, oops. Okay.
Yeah.
I should stop looking. So in terms of disclosures, at this point, not too many drug companies actually come talk to me because we're in pediatrics and they do all their studies in adults. So I don't think it's, and I agree with Sean, I think, as a pediatric physician even more so, I don't have a problem with working with industry to advance the goals of improving care of children. And I think that I agree with him. In some ways, it's impossible for us to do that without some discussion, but I think it's just how you frame that discussion. Okay, so our objectives today are to review phenotypes of asthma, and to review what's known about the development of asthma. And I want to tell you guys about a really novel study that we're doing called the Canadian Healthy Infant Longitudinal Development Study, or the CHILD study. And it's value for answering some of the questions that we're talking about in terms of the environment and the development of asthma in pediatrics. And I just want to spend a little time highlighting some of the key findings from the CHILD study that we've had from Toronto. Okay, I always like to start with a few cases. So this is a case of a young boy who was referred to me at age 5 months for persistent wheezing. He had his first emergency room visit for wheeze at 3 months of age. He had no family history of asthma or allergy. He had no personal history of allergy or eczema. He wheezed with colds, which is the most common phenotype in pediatrics. And he was, we were able to do skin prick testing or allergy testing for him at 1 year to environmental allergens, and he was completely negative. But he was responding to bronchodilators. So if you gave him Ventolin, the wheeze did improve. We had another case of a four-year-old boy, a little bit older. He had had an ICU admission for his wheezing. His symptoms had started at the age of two. He'd already had 6 admissions in his short life for asthma. His family history was a father who had asthma. His skin prick test, so his allergy testing, showed that he was positive. positive already to cats, dogs, and mold. But he had lots of triggers. So he didn't just wheeze with colds, he wheezed with activity. So if he was very active or running around, he would start to wheeze. And he had problems in the summer when it was very humid. He had a history of eczema, and he also responded to Ventolin. So do they have asthma? And does it matter? So they both respond to your blue puffers. So do we really care if they have the label of asthma? So if we want to talk about that, we first have to understand what is asthma. So asthma is it's a heterogeneous syndrome. That basically means there's a lot of different ways that people present. And there's a lot of different things that cause wheezing. Asthma is one where it's also characterized by reversible episodes of airway narrowing. That means that you have discrete periods when you're wheezing, you remove the thing that's causing you to wheeze, and in between you feel symptomatically better. But the aim of treatment is not only to prevent those discrete wheezing episodes. The aim of treatment is to actually control your symptoms, prevent your exacerbations, or prevent those attacks, but also to prevent the fixed airflow limitation. So what that is actually that your lung narrowing becomes fixed with asthma. We're trying to prevent that. So this is the test that we were just talking about, spirometry. I thought I'd give you a little bit of a refresher, especially in pediatrics, because not many pediatricians really use this test as much as they should. So spirometry is the most commonly ordered test, and you heard that it's actually not that commonly ordered. And a lot of information can be gleaned from this relatively simple test. But you need a couple of different things to do this test. One, you need a cooperative patient. So somebody who can follow instructions, usually verbal, and they have to be able to form a seal around the mouthpiece. And then they have to take a deep breath in, which is what's happening here, and then through that mouthpiece be able to force out a quick and rapid exhalation. Okay? So if you can do that properly, you can get actually quite a bit of information from this test. So you can get a sense of how big the lungs are by the forced vital capacity. That's the total amount of gas that you can get out in that breath. And you can also get out a measure of what's called the FEV1, so the forced expiratory volume in 1 second. That's the amount of air you can force out of your lungs in 1 second. So you can imagine that if you're breathing through a straw, which is what some of my asthmatic patients will describe, it's really hard to force out a big volume in 1 second. And that's essentially what this test does. It's extremely simple. But most kids under the age of 6 to 8 will have trouble performing this test. There's some newer ways that we can do it, so we're even getting success in a very young child, 3 and 4. But we still have no way to guide the therapy and monitor them as well. So the second part of the discussion is really, how do we describe the phenotype? So what are phenotypes? They're the cluster of symptoms that a patient presents with that helps us determine what are the underlying biology. So what's different about that patient compared to other patients? So there have been many attempts to do this in the past, and they've really been dependent on the clinician describing them. And so what you'll see is that parents often will say, okay, what kind of, are they going to outgrow their asthma? Do they have transient asthma, so the asthma that's present in early childhood but then is no longer persistent? Do they have childhood onset versus adult onset? And all of these are the way that clinicians have traditionally described them. In recent years, we've moved to something called cluster methodology. So that's taking all of the data that the patients are telling us and using computers and different ways of analyzing it to give us a little bit more information about, wait a minute, if this group of patients are very similar and they have these kind of characteristics associated with them, and they tend to have this course in their disease. So we've been really moving towards this non-biased approach using machine learning to try and develop these newer kinds of phenotypes. And I think Sean's presentation really demonstrated that, in that the patients often are not aligning their diagnoses with the physicians. And it's maybe because as part of it is that, you know, the clinician has a certain set of characteristics that they know about that make up a diagnosis, but there are in fact many, many other things that we may not be asking the right questions to fully understand. So one of the first attempts to really rigorously and prospectively characterize early childhood wheezing in the general population was this article that was published in the New England Journal of Medicine in 1995. And what they did was they took a population in Tucson and they recruited 1,246 infants. These were not high-risk infants, this was the general population. And they followed them for the first 6 years of life. And they did some regular assessments of wheeze. They worked with the pediatric offices. And almost what they found was that almost half the population, so what you see here is that almost half the population actually wheezes. So 51% had never experienced a wheeze within the first 6 years. That means almost 50% did, okay? But they usually only had one episode. You had the early onset transient wheeze. These are kids that had wheezing in the first 3 years of life, but after that, between 3 and 6, did not wheeze again. You had the late onset wheeze, which are kids who had wheezing that appeared after 3 years of age and was still present at 6. And then you have the early onset persistent wheezes. These are the kids that were wheezing before 3, and they kept wheezing up until age 6. And that was traditionally how people thought of asthma. And then along came another study in the last decade. And what they really did was they took it on a much bigger scale and said, you know what? These patients that we're seeing in the clinic are not quite that simple. So let's really try and tease out, this was like 3,500 patients. Let's really try and tease out all these different types of phenotypes. So what you see though is actually fairly similar. So you have these transient early wheezers. These are the kids in blue. They either have transient early or prolonged early, but at the end of the day, they wheeze a lot. This is the probability that they're wheezing. So, you know, most of them are wheezing early, and then they start to fall off, and they really come down to normal. They're not really wheezing by the time they get to 5 and 6. You have kids who have late onset wheezing. So these are the kids who really weren't wheezing in the first year, but start to wheeze later. And these are the kids who actually have ATP. And so we started to think, okay, maybe ATP or allergy is actually driving that rise in the wheezing rates. Interestingly though, you have this group of subjects who are the persistent wheezers. They've been wheezing right from the get-go, okay? And they have, they're not really driven by allergy. But all of these groups, the ones who are wheezing by the time they're 6, they're still having symptoms, they have worse lung function, all right? And basically, by age 4 to 5, that's when we're starting to see what's starting to be a persistent case. Sorry, let me just go back here for a second. Now, how does that help us in the two patients that we talked about at the beginning? So we have the first one who is presenting at age 5 months. It really doesn't help you as a clinician. You know, you're sitting there going, you have a kid in your office. He could be any one of these categories, and you don't know. And what about the four-year-old? Okay, well here, it's probably, you know, you still have the prolonged early that's going to be dropping, and just as much you have the kids who have the persistent or the late onset. ATP is giving you a clue that maybe they're the ones who are going to continue to wheeze, but beyond that, we didn't have a lot more. So with the advent of more sophisticated computational techniques, they really use these to cluster the phenotypes based on the pattern of symptoms. And they use this in a couple of different ways as well. What we found was that the kids who had allergy, we went back and they went back and they looked at 3 different cohorts and they really found the same thing. You had that same cluster of about 5 to 6 different phenotypes. And they were really, the pattern of allergy or sensitization really helped to distinguish those phenotypes. And what they found that the groups that had more severe early allergies tend to have a worse outcome and have more persistent symptoms. So the finding of the association of wheeze with allergy seem to increase your risk of having asthma for longer. Okay. And beyond ATP, what they found was that the multiple sensitization, so that's the kids who had lots of allergy plus wheezing, they tended to have worse asthma. So this is a risk of hospitalization. And you can see that the kids who had lots of early allergies tended to be in the worst category in terms of their risk of hospitalization. And you know, when you try and figure out, well, what is it? What allergy is it that's really driving this? It seemed to be the aeroallergens, and dust mites seem to be particularly problematic. That, although you have to take with a grain of salt, because the pattern of allergies is different in different regions, and so often you'll hear about people who are quite bad in Toronto moving to the prairies, and for a while they're better. And it might be due to the fact that you have different allergens, but they found that the kids who had dust mite, particularly, probably because it's an allergen that's around all the time, year through, they tended to also be slightly worse. Whereas the kids who had late allergies or the kids who had no allergies tended to be the most protected. So around the same time, a good friend of mine and colleague, Dr. Malcolm Sears, was really interested in the development of that persistent airflow or lung changes. So he actually was privileged enough to become part of a birth cohort study that was run out of New Zealand. And they recruited over 1,000 patients in this small town, all of the children that were born in a small hospital over a one-year period in the 1970s. And a developmental pediatrician actually started the study that was really interested in neurodevelopmental outcomes. So she started following this group. She followed them for the first 3 years of life, and she kept bringing them back. Slowly, more and more researchers became involved with this study. So Malcolm became involved at age 9. And from that, he really came up with some seminal papers. And the key one was this one. It was based on what he did was he followed all those children, at this point, up to age 26. And he found the following key findings. So what he shows here is that he actually measured spirometry in all of the 9-year-olds and kept doing it until they were 26. And what he showed actually really dramatically shifted how respirologists really viewed asthma. And we found that the kids who were followed in this cohort by age 9 were already showing signs of airways obstruction. So this is the amount you can blow out in 1 second over the total amount of gas in your lung. And you can see that for normal, healthy individuals, which are the purple line here, they actually are able to get out most of their air in 1 second by the time they're 9. But as they got older, unfortunately, every one of us after the age of 21 experiences a slight decline in our lung function. And maybe we'll hear from the environmental folks if that was also preventable. But this is a normal decline in all of our lung function. What he found in the children with asthma who had either persistent wheezing or what was called relapsing wheezing, so those are kids who documented wheezing at more than 2 or 3 of these assessments. They didn't have to have wheezing at every single one, but it was a type of asthma that came back at some point. Those kids had low lung function at the first time of measurement at age 9, and they continued on that trajectory. Interestingly, these are community, general population people. So these are not, the kinds of asthmatics that you see in a tertiary care center. And so their rate of decline is actually very similar to those that are healthy. And that's something that, has been looked at in other studies, that perhaps the more severe you are, you may have an even accelerated decline. But in those people who have even mild community asthma, there is an element of fixed airflow limitation. And what was also interesting about this, and this has changed, so I have to modify this slide now, but we used to say people who had The reason why we cared about this, you know, this fixed airflow limitation, is that the way that COPD has been traditionally diagnosed is that if you have airways obstruction that is taking your lung function to below that cutoff, that's traditionally how the diagnosis of COPD was made. And so what was happening was that some of these kids who had been remitting or kind of put away the label of asthma had actually presented in later ages with this diagnosis of COPD. That was the theory. And he actually showed that that decline was happening at such a rate that they didn't reach their maximal growth in their lungs. And so with that asthma diagnosis on top, they had a decline that actually put them into the COPD range. So that kind of panicked us pediatricians, because all of a sudden, asthma became not something that the adults could really try and repair at that point. It meant that the pediatricians had to do a better job of figuring out who was asthmatic and seeing if we could treat them earlier. So how early do we see these changes? So I was working with Dr. Sears during my training at the Firestone, and then I went to England to train for a year with Janet Stocks, and what we did there was we focused on infant and preschool lung function. So I returned to Toronto in 2004, and I set up for the first time a state-of-the-art pulmonary function lab. And by 2005, I had hired an excellent respiratory therapist by the name of Susan Balkovic to help us make this goal a reality. And later that year, we obtained the first commercial licensed FDA-approved infant pulmonary function system, and we were off to the races. So initially, we started off with clinically licensed tests of infant, this is basically looking at their lung volumes or infant spirometry. But by 2007, I was able to bring to Toronto a new technology called Lung Clearance Index, or Multiple Breath Washout, which for us has been really innovative in terms of looking at other ways of measuring the lung function in kids who can't do spirometry. So the Multiple Breath Washout test is a really simple test, and it's really old technology. There's nothing novel about this. This was actually developed in the 60s and became repurposed for modern use in the last 10 to 15 years. Basically, all it is it's a tidal breathing test where you breathe in an inert gas, and we also have something called an inert gas in your resident in your lung. An inert gas is simply a gas that doesn't interact with you physiologically. So it's not like oxygen or carbon dioxide. Your body doesn't produce it at any appreciable rate. For the purposes of this presentation, I'm going to focus on an exogenous inert gas, something called SF6. Basically, we use SF6 and helium. Helium kind of runs by the same principle. These are gases that normally are not in the air. And what you do is you breathe it in, and it tells you some really key information about the peripheral airways. And gives us information about early airflow limitation, perhaps before it affects the larger airways as measured by spirometry. But it really adds complementary information. So essentially what happens is young child or baby is sleeping with a face mask. And what we do is we put something called a pneumotachometer. It's basically a face mask attached to a computer. These are lines that tell us that measure the flow, and so they tell us how quickly the patient is breathing. There's another little analyzer here. It's a sampling system that goes to something called a mass spectrometer, which actually is able to measure the gas concentration in every single breath instantaneously. During the test, they breathe in, we give them a supply of room air mixed in with a little bit of 4% SF6, so it's very similar to helium, and we do helium as well. And what they do is they breathe this gas in, and they do that until the breath in and breath out is equilibrated with this 4% SF6. So the mass spectrometer measures the concentration, and what you see here is during the breath in and breath out, the concentration of gas is 4%. Then you remove that gas source from their breathing mask, and they start to breathe in room air. And what you see is during the first breath in, There's no gas in the room, no SS6 in room air, and so the gas concentration falls down to zero. They take a breath out, and the gas concentration rises as it comes out of your lungs, and so on and so forth, until you get to the end of the test, which is normally, it's just by convention, taken as when you get to 1/40th of the initial gas concentration, so 0.01%. So this is a healthy infant. It's a very simple test. So what you see here is, this is how long it took for a healthy infant to blow out all of this SS6, and this is how long it took for an infant with cystic fibrosis. It just takes them much longer to get rid of that gas. So it's, you know, but from this extremely simple test, you can get a ton of physiologic parameters. For this test, we're going to concentrate just on the simplest one for this presentation. It's called the lung clearance index. It's the most commonly reported parameter, and basically, it tells you how well your lungs are able to ventilate and their efficiency with which they can exhale this tracer gas. What we can do is we can measure the total amount of volume to get rid of that gas, and we divide it by the baby's own resting lung volume. And so you get an index. So you can imagine if it takes you a lot longer to expire that gas, many, many more breaths, this number goes up, this number stays same because that's what their capacity is. And therefore, a higher lung clearance index means that you have worse lung function. So the next test, so we had this newly set up facility for the first time in infants, and I wanted to know whether the lung function deficits that my colleague described in adults could be detected in infants that were severe enough to be referred to a coronary care center. So we studied the infants who had a significant wheezing disorder that resulted in a hospitalization, and we tested them 3 months after their illness, so when they were actually stable from a clinical perspective. And these are kids that the parents would say, yep, they're fine, they're not wheezing, they're asymptomatic. And then we wanted a comparator group. So we used children with cystic fibrosis because during my training in England, I knew that children with cystic fibrosis had evidence of lung disease. And I wanted to understand the lung disease in infants with wheezing in the context of somebody who we knew had more significant lung disease. But I also knew from my training in England that we really needed a healthy control group because we wanted to know what was a normal lung. So luckily at the time, we were planning the child study. And our hypothesis was really that infants with recurrent wheeze would have mild deficits compared to the CF patients, but both would be worse than the healthy controls. So what did we see? So interestingly, first we patted ourselves on the back because we recruited healthy controls. And thank goodness that we did, because our healthy controls were actually lower than the healthy controls that had been previously published. So if we did not have that and we just compared ourselves to what was known internationally, we would have thought that there was no deficit. What we found in the kids who had recurrent wheezing was actually their LCI and their mean LCI was higher than the infants who had cystic fibrosis. So, and we also discovered that almost 43% of the infants had LCI values that were actually much higher than the bulk of healthy individuals, suggesting that perhaps we had some inkling of a test that might be helping us with our diagnosis. So if we return to our cases, what does that tell us? So in the case of the infant who was 5 months old, he was tested when he was about 2.5. And as you recall, he had no allergies. And his infant spirometry was actually normal. He had no evidence of a bronchodilator response and normal spirometry, which is often what you see in asthmatics when they're well controlled. On the other hand, his lung clearance index was actually very abnormal, suggesting that there was actually some lung function changes still happening. In the case of the young boy who'd been to the to the ICU, he actually had lots of allergies, and his LCI was also extremely high. So it was telling us that these kids both had evidence of some lung compromise. So now I told you that we recruited healthy infants. Now let me tell you why. In 2006, CIHR and Allergan both announced that they wanted to study the role of the environment and gene interactions in the development of asthma and allergy. At the time, Malcolm Sears was able to bring together a team of over 41 co-investigators to really study this question. Under our leadership, Dr. Sears and myself brought together a multi-center national cohort with our co-PIs, Dr. Stuart Turvey, Alan Becker in Winnipeg, Keish Vandane in Edmonton, and Theo Boris in Toronto. So I've just recently taken over directorship, and Stuart Turvey is now my co-director and still the site leader in Toronto. But we have these four recruitment sites and then a national coordinating center in Hamilton. And what we did in the child study was we really focused on building an infrastructure that would allow us to recruit over 3,600 women and during pregnancy. And with the understanding that asthma is, the origins of asthma are in very early life, we really focused our measurements on the pregnant woman and the young infant up until age 3. And then we followed them up every 2 years afterwards to see what their outcomes would be. So we recruited a general population cohort of pregnant women, and we really wanted to make sure that we focused on the general population rather than a high-risk group. And there are a couple of reasons for this. One is that if you look at the asthma clinics and actually the asthma populations today, over half of them, or nearly half of them, actually do not have a family history of asthma. So if you only focus on children who are at high risk, you may really miss some key risk factors in terms of the environment that may be predisposing those children to asthma, and such that their parents didn't actually have the disease. Notably, we did not include children born early, before 35 weeks, or those resulting from in vitro fertilization, because they actually have environmental changes that are not due to the external environment, but actually that are unique to the way that they have been born. And we did not focus on children under 35 weeks because we know that there are lung injuries that are happening from a child being born early that are independent of some of the risk factors that the general population may experience in the development of asthma. So what are some of the key components in the child study? Well, we undertook to assess the home environments by questionnaire in pregnancy and in each year up until 5 years, both by direct home inspection and dust sampling at 3 months of age. We collected and stored blood in the cord at 1 and 5 years. We documented viral and other infections in the first year of life. We examined immune and inflammatory responses to pathogens, allergens, and markers of innate and immune function. We measured lung function in infancy in Toronto and at 1 and 3 years, and in 5 years in the entire cohort. We obtained family history by questionnaire, skin tests, lung function, and obtained parental DNA. So that was one unique aspect of our cohort studies, that we actually measured the parents as well. And then we assessed the psychosocial and stress environment during pregnancy and during annual follow-up. So we had a very aggressive timeline. And we recruited over a 3-year period, and we anticipate the complete cleaning of the 5-year data by next year, actually 2019 there. Our last infant will be turning 5 in the next few months. So what we did was, this is just to show you what we did in Toronto, and we did a very intensive infant pulmonary function cohort in this group, and we saw them all at 3 years for lung function testing again. And we did quite a bit of measurements in that early time period. So the study was really powered on the primary diagnosis of asthma at age 5. And we also looked at intermediate outcomes of food and inhalant sensitization, food allergy, atopic dermatitis, and recurrent wheeze that was assessed throughout. So what have we learned already? So based on the data accumulated to age one, we already had several key findings that have been summarized in this infographic. We found that decreased gut bacteria was associated with increased food sensitization at 1 year. We found that antibiotics given during labor decreases gut microbiota, but this effect was modified by breastfeeding. We found that environmental exposures via detailed home inspections and assessments were done in over 30 to 200 homes, constituting one of the largest in-depth environmental home assessments ever done. And we found that cesarean delivery and formula feeding can alter the microbiome. And recently we had some high impact publications, one suggesting that 4 critical gut bacteria in the first 100 days are critical to protecting children against the development of asthma. And beyond asthma, we found that air pollution increases the risk of allergies by age one. But recognizing that in the study we'd actually gotten a very comprehensive assessment of early life risk factors, not just for asthma, but in fact chronic disease overall, we developed the child data set to be interrogated for factors related to other disorders. And so more recently, investigators interested in neurocognitive development looked at the impact of fruit consumption and found that increased fruit consumption during pregnancy was associated with a boost in cognitive development. And finally, that sweetener intake in pregnancy could increase the risk, baby's risk of obesity, whether even using non-nutritive sweeteners. I want to just focus on one of the allergy findings, sorry, the asthma findings. And the reason why is I think this is the, what we hope at least is unique about the child study is that beyond the epidemiological association, we want to go that one step further and really understand perhaps some of the mechanisms which really can't be done in some of these large epidemiological trials. So the group in Vancouver, and led by Stuart Turvey and Brett Finley, sought and received additional funding to study how the intestinal microbiota, or the gut bugs, could affect immune development. And they hypothesized that specific microbial populations could play a protective or harmful role. And they did this by taking the association data from the cohort and designing a series of animal model studies to further investigate their findings. So first, when they explored the cohort data, they found that the infants belonging to one of these 4 phenotypes, they looked at ATP plus wheeze versus ATP only, wheeze only in controls, but they found the differences to be quite strong between those who had atopic wheeze and controls. And what they show here is these are infants were at 3 months of age, and these are the bugs in their gut, and they found that the kids who were wheezing with ATP or allergic sensitization at 1 year had a significant decrease in 4 critical gut microbiota. And they termed them flavor because, well, they're weird. but they didn't want to say the whole word. So this is this one starts with F, it's fecal bacterium. They had lactobacillus and vianella and rothia species. So they called these flavor. And they showed that they were low at 3 months of age. But by the time the kids reached 1 year of age, those differences were no longer present, suggesting that something was happening in the very early time period that seemed to be different in those kids who developed atopic wheeze. They then took this association data and put it into a mouse model. So what they did was they took the stool sample from this atopic wheezing child with the deficiencies in the 4 gut bugs, and they inoculated the mice with this deficient stool strain. And in another group of mice, they actually supplemented the species of that were missing. And they showed that the children born to the inoculated mice harbored those strains, so they actually had low flavor. Then they went on to, they looked at the mice born to the deficient mice mothers and found that those mice also had that same deficiency in those 4 gut microbiota. And you can see here that they looked at their lung from a pathological sample, and they showed that the ones who had the deficiency actually had a lot more inflammation than those who were naive mouse or a natural mouse. And in the mice that were supplemented with those gut microbiota, they were able to diminish the amount of inflammation, so almost normalize them. And they showed the same thing in terms of when they looked at the lung fluid from these mice. So moving on, I want to just focus a little bit on what we've learned in trial. So in trial, we really focused on an intensive study of the lung function from infancy. And we wanted to know whether the infants with significant wheezing disorders who had been admitted, who had wheezing episodes, would show the same pattern as Malcolm Sears' data, and when the changes in lung function were actually happening. So what we did was, out of the 768 participants in Toronto, we had 231 infants who elected to have their children participate in this aspect of the study. There were extra visits, and so we got about a third of the parents who actually volunteered to do this extra level of intensity. And in those 231 children, we followed them up at age 3 and 90% of them. So we had a really engaged group of volunteers who really believed in what we were doing and really went the extra mile to get this study done. And we were able to do a number of different lung function tests in these infants. So we did the multiple breath washout, we looked at their lung volumes, we did infant spirometry, and we attempted to do their lung function after ventilating. So by age 3, we were able to take those pulmonary function trajectories and look at whether they were different between these epidemiologically defined wheeze phenotypes. So the way the clinicians actually looked at it, and tried to figure out the kids who had described wheezing at multiple time points, how did they differ amongst those who had no wheeze? So the children who had no wheeze had never experienced wheeze at any point. The children who had what we defined as recurrent had wheezing that was still present at the age of 3. And then the transient wheezers were those kids who wheezed in the first 2 years of life, but were no longer wheezing at age 3. And what we found, So what we found here was that, this is the demographics by the time they came back with their follow-up. So you'll see that there's no real difference in their weights, and no real difference in their heights. And what I just want to point out that's unique about Canada is that if you look at the population that we studied in this cohort, maybe it's representative of Toronto, that they're not the typical study that you see. We actually have a very multicultural population, and so our cohorts reflect that, which is quite unique. So the minority of children were Caucasian. Actually, many of them were of mixed ethnicity. And what you see here is, as expected, which is traditionally described, usually in the very young age, it's typically boys that have wheezing, fewer girls at that point. And that gender switch happens around age 8 to 11. You can also see here that our frequency of parental wheezing probably had a slightly increased likelihood of participating in the study if you had a family history of asthma, but we still had quite a few people who had no family history of asthma participating. And what you see here is the aeroallergen sensitization, so how many had environmental allergies. And you can see that the kids who have the recurrent wheezing tended to have much higher rates of allergy sensitization, and they also had a higher rate of parental asthma and food allergy. So this is something that's been coming out more and more, is that the kids who tend to have quite severe asthma also have multiple allergies, not just to the environment, but also to food. And what we found, which was really quite interesting for us, was that we actually found that the kids who had transient wheezing, so those kids who had early wheezing, but then were no longer wheezing at age three, had lung clearance index, so the lung test was higher, suggesting that they had some lung function abnormalities in the first 6 months of life. But by age one to two, it had normalized. And by age three, they were indistinguishable from the healthy controls. Whereas the children who were having recurrent wheezing and who we suspect may go on to develop asthma actually had no problems in their lung function at birth. And were quite unchanged from the healthy population until probably around 18 months or 2 years. And then by age three, they were significantly higher. So they had more lung disease compared to healthy controls. And when we looked at the infant spirometry, it shows the same picture, which is reassuring that the tests are telling us the same story. So when we look at how obstructed they are, so how much air can they get out in one in infants, it's less than 1 second, it's half a second, compared to the total amount of gas in their lung, they actually, the kids who had the transient or early wheezing had signs of airways obstruction which resolved, and the same picture in the kids who had recurrent wheezing. They actually were within normal limits until about 18 months or 2 years, and then they started to decline. And by age three, they were very different from their healthy control counterparts and from the kids who had transient wheezing. So in summary, we found that the trajectories in lung function were impaired in children who had wheezing illness. And by age three, the children with recurrent wheeze had elevated LCI values. So the other aspect that we really wanted to understand is how could these tests help us in practice? So we wanted to look at whether or not these tests could help us in the three-year-old. So we took the children who, we had many more children who actually consented to do the lung function at age three, and they all came in for the testing at that point. And what we looked at in this context was whether or not they had changes in their lung function based on their wheeze phenotype. So here we have all of the children were seen by a study physician at 3 years of age, and the physicians tried to assess whether or not they had preschool asthma. And what we found is the kids who had a diagnosis of preschool asthma tended to have higher lung clearance index than those who were healthy. And in fact, there were some that were quite abnormal compared to the healthy controls and actually would have shown up as at the individual level as a diagnostic test. But what was more interesting is that if you know, because physicians often have difficulty in making that diagnosis, especially when it's clinically based, we went back and looked at just the patients who said that they had wheezing. And what was the relationship of these lung function parameters to that symptom? And we saw that actually kids who had more than two episodes of wheeze had a much higher LCI as a group than the kids who were healthy or had a single episode of wheeze. So in essence, it's telling us that, you know, one of the key questions that physicians should be asking the patient is, how often are they wheezing? And I think we get a little bogged down in pediatrics between cough and wheeze, but what we find is that if you're wheezing recurrently, your lungs are showing signs of that. So returning to our cases, you know, case one had an elevated LCI value, and by seven, he had a bronchodilator response symptoms and was confirmed as a non-atopic asthmatic, which is fairly uncommon. And case two also had a bronchodilator response and a more typical presentation of atopic asthma. And so in summary, I think the early life changes predispose infants to developing asthma and allergies, and later onset wheezing is associated with long-term asthma. By age three, children with preschool asthma have changes in their lung function. So our take-home message is perhaps not at three, but I think it's very similar to what Sean has said as well, is that You know, by the time your kids are at least 8, the take-home message is you need to advocate for actually having their lung function measured. I think that will give us a lot of information to actually guide the therapy. So the future work really goes around, are these changes in lung function modifiable? And what are the factors that are associated with asthma that goes into remission? And that's a big question. And if you look at what Dr. Aaron's data is showing and what some of the older literature shows, is that a proportion of these kids, especially some of the boys, do go into remission. We need to tease out which of those children go into remission permanently compared to kids who have relapses and really understand that from a physiologic perspective. So really, all I can say to you for those questions is watch this space. And I'd like to take this opportunity to thank all of our funders who've been instrumental in getting this landmark study going and maintaining it. And I need to thank my team and all of the wonderful participants who participated in the child study. This is a little girl who came in for her 5-year visit. And I'm really proud of this picture because she loved the child study so much and she had to do her kindergarten project on what she did, and she did it all about the child study. And I just thought that was amazing. So thank you so much. The asthma prevalence rate, at least the school age asthma that's diagnosed by the physicians, is about 12 to 13%.
12 to 13. Okay. And do you have any predictions on what variables, what factors are going to be most predictive of developing asthma in this age group?
Yeah.
I know you haven't analyzed it yet, but what's your gut feeling?
Yeah. So it's allergic sensitization for sure is driving the persistent asthmatics. But what I think is really interesting that we need to tease out are those children that are, there is still a proportion of the wheezing. So of the 12%, about 10% of those kids actually are non-atopic, and they actually have lung function changes that are not driven by allergy. And I think those kids are really interesting because they're very tough to treat. And you know, we had some early data presented by one of my students in another session, and she, sorry about that. They really don't want me to tell you. But what she found is actually that these early changes in lung function was actually a risk factor for later wheezing. So, you know, if you measure the lung clearance index at age 3, it was predictive of the children who went on to have asthma diagnosis at age 5. So I think it's really interesting because you have a ton of kids who have allergy who don't develop asthma, but there's something that if you put together the lung changes, they're predictive, and so is allergic sensitization. So that pattern is very, I think we can move the diagnosis much earlier on if we can actually figure out a way to feasibly do both the lung function and the allergic sensitization, which is fairly simple to do.
Thank you.
Anyway, I just want to congratulate you, PJ, on some wonderful work that's been ongoing, and anyway, lots of interesting stuff coming out of that. Children that I can do spirometry on, many of them are chronic coughers, many of them just have rhinitis or whatever. What does this Brett washout look like in those groups? You alluded to the fact that it may be predictive later on, and it would be great to be able to study some of them.
Yeah, so what's really cool is, beyond the work that I'm doing in asthma, there's a whole wealth of literature in cystic fibrosis. And what they show is actually, if you just have cough and a cold, an upper respiratory infection, in the absence of asthma or another diagnosis, your lung clearance is not affected. So if you take healthy kids who have a cough and a cold, their LCIs are normal. Now, before we get too much, and I've spent the last 10 years on LCI, so if anyone's going to be on the bandwagon, it's going to be me. Let me put a word of caution out. This is not a diagnostic test right now. Okay, so if you look at any of these tests and you take them into looking at their sensitivity and specificity, it really is just part of the picture. And that's why I think measures of inflammation and understanding the allergic side are critically important. So you need to put those things together with the history, which is what our guidelines say, and then you can start to label these kids more appropriately.
Anyway, thanks. The other pitch I'm going to make is for allergy, which no matter what comes up repeatedly, and it is a risk factor. And I think that it's time even for us as allergists to sort of take the plunge and treat early. There's enough data, and a lot of it is not perfect. I mean, these studies are not easy to do. But there's enough database, data and studies of early childhood treatment, especially in house dust mite, which is more of an issue than pollens, where early immunomodulation will either prevent or lessen asthma, as well as the amount of medications. And really, I mean, we don't know much about modification.
Exactly.
Yeah, whether it's, viral illness initially that sort of sets the stage for people becoming more allergic or vice versa, I have no clue. But I think that we lend a lot of lip service to it all starts in childhood and then we forget about it till much later. So
I completely agree with you. I think one of the things though that I really wanted to see that I don't think they were able to do in the SLIT study, which is the sublingual immunotolerance studies, is to see if this actually had a modifying effect on the lung function, on the growth. Because I think what's really interesting from not just our data, but international cohorts, is that when you start to show that decline in lung function, those kids are at risk for further disease later on. And I think one of the really striking things is that, just as Sean said, you wouldn't treat diabetes without a sugar test. You don't treat hypertension without a blood pressure measurement. And similarly, we can't really treat lung disease without a measurement, okay? We can't recognize it, we can't manage it, and we, as a result, haven't really moved forward in terms of disease-modifying therapies, and I think that's a focus for the future. So I think it's an important question. I don't know that we have all of the answers yet. What we do know from a couple of studies, including ours, is that low lung function is a risk factor for infections and for relapsing asthma. What we don't know is in those people who are asymptomatic, who have minor deficits, we don't know how long before they have relapse. And we don't know 100% of the time whether they all relapse, right? So that's why these general population cohort studies are really important. Many of the studies that have looked at lung function as a risk factor previously were done in high-risk groups, and there may be lots of immune changes that are happening. But I think what we have to do as a community is really start to focus not just on lung function or the allergy. It's the combination that gives you the typical presentation of asthma. And furthermore, when you talk about treatments, yes, the vast majority of kids who have mild to moderate asthma, who have allergy respond really nicely to inhaled steroids. There are a small fraction who don't, and I think we need to really start to understand what their underlying inflammation is, their biology, and really hone in on some better tests and you know, more aggressively understanding the biology.
I'm Lavazma Kevin, and we have another question over Twitter. Actually, this one's over Facebook. Someone has asked if you can go into a bit more detail about the effects of pollution on asthma in children.
I think I'm going to leave that for Dr. Takaro, who's going to be speaking this afternoon about the role of the environment in asthma. But I will say we had some really nice data looking at outdoor air pollution. Higher levels of outdoor air pollution being associated with increased allergy sensitization at 1 year of age. And that's something, a story that we're continuing to follow. In Toronto, we have a relatively smaller data set, so we were unable to show definitively that you're seeing changes in the lungs in children who are exposed to slightly higher levels of air pollution. Mind you, they're all in Toronto. but you know, if you look at the levels of air pollution, even in Toronto, the studies that have shown it had much higher levels of air pollution. So I don't think we know the answers yet. It's still something that I don't know if we even are measuring all the same right things still. So that's some of the stuff that I'm sure Tim will be talking about this afternoon.
Thanks for that preview, PJ. Be sure not to fall asleep after lunch. My question was about the non-allergic but reduced lung function population. And there is more and more talk now about chronic obstructive pulmonary disease occurring in children. Do you think that this subpopulation may be that early COPD?
I can't say that's true yet, obviously, for our cohort, because I don't see evidence at 3 that they are distinguishable from healthies, but some of the other cohorts have shown that those kids actually continue to have slightly lower lung function. I mean, I think that's the million-dollar question is, what is their lung growth like? And there's a lot of data coming out now from some of these adult cohorts, it shows that about nearly 50% of adult COPD patients actually, if you track back their lung function, they start out in early adulthood with less than maximal lung growth. So there's obviously some of those people who in earlier life, we're not quite sure when, have had their lung growth impaired.
Related to that, you challenged we in the environmental field to predict whether or not we can reverse the decline in lung function later in life. I was curious to see on your graph that while it was not statistically significant yet, the trajectory for normal was downward between age 1 and 3.
For the lung clearance index.
Yes.
Yeah. So lung clearance index does slightly decrease, which is good, right? It means it's normalizing. But it may be related also to differences in how you do the test. So that's actually been described before. And it's really hard to tease out because the infants are done while they're lying down, whereas the 3-year-olds are done sitting up and cooperative. So slightly different changes in techniques as well.
So probably artifact in a sense of
maybe,
the test.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm not sure we can help you after age 20. Sorry about that.
Thank you.
Just a question about alpha 1 antitrypsin. Was that ever brought up in any of the ones that you couldn't explain if it wasn't an allergic feature?
So, you know, we haven't looked at alpha 1 antitrypsin in this cohort yet, but generally in pediatrics, the alpha-1 antitrypsin patients present with liver disease first, and